the Son, and of the Holy Spirit.
Amen.
Grace, mercy, and peace from God our Father, and the Lord Jesus Christ be with you.
And also with you.
Dear brothers and sisters, welcome to St. George's and to the Eucharist this morning. Today we will listen to the Gospel of Jesus being transfigured. It is 6 days after Jesus said, "If any want to become my followers, let them deny themselves and take up their cross and follow me." So, as we are just a few days before the beginning of Lent, the Lent season, this Gospel, which makes us perceive our Lord's glory, may strengthen us as we prepare for this important season of the liturgical year. As we begin our celebration today, let us first confess our sins in penitence and faith, firmly resolved to keep God's commandments and to live in love and peace with all. Almighty God, God, who forgives all who truly repent, have mercy upon you, pardon and deliver you from all your sins, confirm and strengthen you in all goodness, and keep you in life eternal, through Jesus Christ our Lord.
Amen. Amen.
Thank you.
Almighty Father, whose Son was revealed in majesty before he suffered death upon the cross, give us grace to perceive his glory, that we may be strengthened to suffer with him and be changed into his likeness from glory to glory. Through Jesus Christ, your Son, our Lord, who is alive and reigns with you in the unity of the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever.
Elijah said to Elisha, "Stay here, for the Lord has sent me as far as Bethel." But Elisha said, "As the Lord lives, and as you yourself live, I will not leave you." So they went down to Bethel. The company of prophets who were in Bethel came out to Elisha and said to him, "Do you know that today the Lord will take your master away from you?" And he said, "Yes, I know. Keep silent." Elijah said to him, "Elisha, stay here, for the Lord has sent me to Jericho." But he said, "As the Lord lives, and as you yourself live, I will not leave you." So they came to Jericho. The company of prophets who were at Jericho drew near to Elisha and said to him, "Do you know that today the Lord will take your master away from you?" And he answered, "Yes, I know. Be silent." Then Elijah said to him, "Stay here, for the Lord has sent me to the Jordan." But he said, "As the Lord lives and as you yourself live, I will not leave you." So the two of them went on. 50 men of the company of prophets also went and stood at some distance from them, as they both were standing by the Jordan. Then Elijah took his mantle and rolled it up and struck the water. The water was parted to one side and to the other until the two of them crossed on dry ground. When they had crossed, Elijah said to Elisha, "Tell me what I may do for you before I am taken from you." Elisha said, "Please let me inherit a double share of your spirit." He responded, "You have asked a hard thing. Yet, if you see me as I am being taken from you, it will be granted you. If not, it will not." As they continued walking and talking, a chariot of fire and horses of fire separated the two of them, and Elijah ascended in a whirlwind into heaven. Elisha kept watching and crying out, "Father, Father, the chariot of Israel and its horsemen." But when he could no longer see him, he grasped his own clothes and tore them in two pieces.
Thank you. lecture de la deuxième lettre de Saint Paul aux Corinthiens. Si cependant notre évangile demeure voilé, il est voilé pour ceux qui se perdent, pour les incrédules, dont le Dieu de ce monde a aveuglé l'intelligence, afin qu'ils ne perçoivent pas l'illumination de l'évangile de la gloire du Christ, lui qui est l'image de Dieu. Non, ce n'est pas nous-mêmes, mais Jésus-Christ Seigneur que nous proclamons. Quant à nous-mêmes, nous nous proclamons vos serviteurs à cause de Jésus. Car le Dieu qui a dit « Que la lumière brille au milieu des ténèbres », c'est lui-même qui a brillé dans nos cœurs pour faire resplendir la connaissance de sa gloire qui rayonne sur le visage du Christ.
Jesus took with him Peter and James and John and led them up a high mountain apart by themselves. And he was transfigured before them, and his clothes became dazzling white, such as no one could bleach them. And there appeared to them Elijah with Moses, who were talking with Jesus. Then Peter said to Jesus, "Rabbi, it is good for us to be here. Let us make three dwellings, one for you, one for Moses, and one for Elijah." He did not know what to say, for they were terrified. Then a cloud overshadowed them, and from the cloud there came a voice, "This is my son, the beloved. Listen to him." Suddenly, when they looked around, they saw no one with them anymore, but only Jesus. As they were coming down the mountain, he ordered them to tell no one about what they had seen until after the Son of Man had risen from the dead. This is the Gospel of the Lord.
Praise to you.
Israel and its horsemen. It doesn't quite trip off the tongue, does it? It's not the sort of exclamation that you might come up with having stubbed your toe or missed the last bus. And probably, who knows, Elisha wasn't exclaiming, expressing his fear, amazement and wonder. It's a theological statement testifying to the unseen forces that surround God's servants. But it is nonetheless an auspicious place to start on Transfiguration Sunday. But I hope that by the end of the sermon, you will not be asking, like Elisha, for a double share. In Hebrew, that's the pishnayim, which actually isn't a double share. It's the sort of legal expression of the two-thirds of the estate that went legally to the eldest born male child. So basically, when it came to it and you went for your soon-to-be deceased father's blessing, then you asked for your pishnayim, your two-thirds of the estate. I hope that by the end of the sermon you will not be asking for a double share, but instead will know that God has prepared for you individually a rich portion, pressed down, shaken down, and overflowing, as it tells us in the scriptures. For today, our attention is not just on the transfiguration as an outworking of our own baptism, but as a practical call to holiness, by drawing a direct line through the length of the events of this Sunday, Transfiguration Sunday, Lent, Holy Week, and Easter. On the mountain you were transfigured, O Christ God, and your disciples beheld your glory as far as they could see it, so that when they would behold you crucified, they would understand that your suffering was voluntary and would proclaim to the world that you are truly the radiance of the Father. That's a verse from the Kantakion of the Transfiguration, a Russian Orthodox hymn. The tune is tone 7, if you're interested. I think you'll agree it loses something in the translation. The point is that they would understand that Christ's suffering was voluntary, for he was truly the radiance of the Father. And Gregory Palamas, the Archbishop of Thessalonica, who died in 1359, and who was, if you like, the Greek father closest to the Latin world in the way in which he did his theology, in his sermon on the Transfiguration, makes that link between what Jesus has said to the disciples and what Peter and James and John and the Gospel writers saw as our participation in the kingdom clear. How can we be so bold? Well, first of all, it's the place in which this story comes. Mark talks of 6 days later. 6 days later, which means that the Transfiguration happened on the seventh day. And what happened on the seventh day? But that God saw all that he had made, and it was good. And then he was at rest. St. Luke, he says that the Transfiguration happened on the eighth day. The eighth day is a Bible code for the perfection and fulfillment of all creation. It is the day upon which all other days are come to their fulfillment. So, back to St. Gregory. Gregory says, even the saints on that day will shine forth like the sun, which is to say they will be entirely permeated by divine light as they gaze upon Christ, divinely and inexpressibly shining forth his radiance, issuing from his divine nature. On Mount Tabor, it was manifest also in his flesh by reason of the hypostatic union. The Fourth Ecumenical Council, which Anglicans sign up to, at Chalcedon, defines this hypostatic union as the union of Christ's two natures, divine and human, without mingling, without change, without division, without separation. Sometimes when you read sermons from the doctors of the church, I feel that I'm not doing too badly. Can't imagine how boring that must have been to listen to the first time. I think St. Paul puts it so much better in 1 Corinthians. For eye has not seen, nor ear heard, nor has it entered into the heart of man, what things God has prepared for those who love him. But to us God has revealed them through his Spirit, for the Spirit searches all things, even the deep things of God. How might we expect to experience the deep things of God? May we hope to journey to those deep things. How can we identify them when we come upon them? Sam Wells, the author of our Lent book, describes those deep things of God as the appearance of forever and today. The appearance of forever and today. And suggests that they may be glimpsed in moments of forgiveness, of liberation, of wonder. Identifying for ourselves those moments in our lives of forgiveness, either given or received, of liberation, whether from fear or from a situation of violence and oppression, and finally, the recognition of the beauty and grace in God's creation, that he identifies as wonder. The appearance of appearance of forever and today, glimpsed in moments of forgiveness, of liberation, of wonder. But our response to those moments, for we have all surely had moments like that, surely comes in a renewed and renewing dialogue with God, an honest speaking of heart to heart, of speaking and of listening, praying in three sorts of ways, praying for the things that God has prepared for those who love him. First, the prayer of resurrection, which practically means, Lord, make my brother better. Secondly, the prayer of incarnation, which practically translates as, please be with my mother at this time. And thirdly, the prayer of transfiguration. Please make this time with my family, with my friends, so that we feel like never before and we look back on this time as giving meaning and purpose to our lives. A prayer of resurrection, make my brother better. A prayer of incarnation, be with my mother or my brother or whoever at this time. A prayer of transfiguration, make this time so like never before that we may look back on this time as giving meaning and purpose to our lives. Now, this prayer can issue forth from all sorts of transfiguring moments with others. We can search them out in all sorts of ways. Even I, however, at this time of COVID, even I, not overly given to country sports, would give my eye teeth to climb even a little hill, never mind Mount Tabor, in searching for transfiguration does not involve becoming the spiritual equivalent of Indiana Jones to find out crystal skulls or indeed tablets of the law. Mount Tabor, the Mount of Transfiguration, is here amongst us. The table in the Coptic Orthodox Church is necessary for the celebration of the Eucharist. It's a wooden box. It doesn't exist outside the Coptic Orthodox Church. For the rest of the church, it is either the relics of the saints or the altar itself. Therefore, for us, Mount Tabor is here. Here it is that reality, bread and wine, is transfigured, transformed, so that we can see the glory and put our hope in God. Chariots of Israel and its horsemen does not trip off the tongue. So I would offer to you instead, brothers and sisters, three words only, spoken at the baptism of Christ as well as his transfiguration, which I hope will trip off your tongue and fill you with confidence that God has prepared for you good things, pressed down, shaken together, and overflowing. My child, my beloved, listen. Spoken to the disciples, spoken to the crowd, spoken to you and me today. Child, beloved, listen.
let us worship the Lord and the responses in the beauty of holiness. Let us worship the Lord
in the beauty of holiness.
Let us pray to the God of glory revealed to us in his Son, Jesus.
Father, lengthen and deepen our attention span as we, your people, listen to your beloved Son, so that we do not fail to hear his will for us or share his longing for the world to be saved. Let us worship the Lord
in the beauty of holiness.
Father, with such humility you entered the world to save it through love's giving. Increase our desire to enter into one another's suffering and hardship, to share the world's resources fairly with one another, and recognize all humanity as brothers and sisters. Let us worship the Lord
in the beauty of holiness.
Father, let us not take one another for granted, but wake each morning ready to notice the Christ in each person we see and speak to, and reverence your hidden presence in all creation. Let us worship the Lord
in the beauty of holiness.
Father, in our prayer, we stand alongside all who are too weak to pray or too confused. May all who are suffering sense your love and comfort and be given strength to persevere and peace of mind and spirit. Let us worship the Lord
in the beauty of holiness.
Father, we commend to your eternal presence those who have recently died, and for Ian Young, priest, who died this week, and especially Elsie Wilde, Cheyennan O'Chelvern, Minnie Powell, and Howard James Avery, whose anniversaries fall this week, that they may rest in peace and rise in glory. Let us worship the Lord
in the beauty of holiness.
Father, thank you for providing always the encouragement and inspiration we need for the work you would have us do. Give us the grace to trust your will for us and walk forward boldly in your company. Merciful Father,
accept these prayers for the sake of your Son, our Savior Jesus Christ. Amen.
Christ is our peace. He has reconciled us to God in one body by the cross. We meet in his name and share his peace. The peace of the Lord be always with you.
And also with you.
Let us offer one another a sign of Christ's peace, respecting social distancing.
Thank you.
rise to sunset, this day is holy, for Christ has risen from the tomb, and scattered the darkness of death, be the light that will not fade. This day the risen Lord walks with your gathered people, unfolds for us your word, and makes himself known in the breaking of the bread. And though the night will overtake this day, you summon us to live in the endless light, the never-ceasing Sabbath of the Lord. And so, with choirs of angels and all the heavenly host, we proclaim your glory and join in their unending hymn of praise. Through Jesus Christ our Lord, as we obey his command, send your Holy Spirit, that broken bread and wine outpoured be before us, the body and blood of your dear Son. On the night before he died, he had supper with his friends, and taking bread, he praised you. He broke the bread, gave it to them, and said, "Take, eat. This is my body which is given for you. Do this in remembrance of me." When supper was ended, he took the cup of wine. Again he praised you, gave it to them and said, "Drink this, all of you. This is my blood of the new covenant, which is shed for you and for many for the forgiveness of sins. Do this as often as you drink it in remembrance of me." Great is the mystery of faith.
Christ has died. Christ is risen. Christ will come again.
So, Father, we remember all that Jesus did. In him we plead with confidence his sacrifice made once for all upon the cross. Bringing before you the bread of life and cup of salvation, we proclaim his death and resurrection until he comes in glory. Lord of all life, help us to work together for that day when your kingdom comes and justice and mercy will be seen in all the earth. Look with favor on your people. Gather us in your loving arms and bring us with Mary the Virgin, Mother of God, George, Genevieve, and all the saints to feast at your table in heaven. Through Christ, and with Christ, and in Christ. In the unity of the Holy Spirit, all honor and glory are yours, O loving Father, forever and ever.
Amen. Amen.
Let us pray with confidence to the Father in the words our Savior gave us. Our Father,
who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from the evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory,
God, who takes away the sins of the world. Blessed are those who are called to his supper.
Lord, I am not worthy to receive you, but only say the word, and I shall be healed.
Vous êtes tous les bienvenus pour prendre la communion, si c'est ce que vous faites dans votre propre église. Si vous ne souhaitez pas communier, vous pouvez vous avancer pendant la communion et vous recevrez une bénédiction. We welcome our visitors to receive communion with us this morning, if that's what you do in your own church. If you don't want to receive Holy Communion, please do come forward for a blessing. Follow the directions of the saints. Let us pray. Holy God, we see your glory in the face of Jesus Christ. May we, who are partakers of his table, reflect his life in word and deed, that all the world may know his power to change and save. This we ask through Jesus Christ, our Lord.
Amen.
Please be seated.
I hope the notices are clear. This Tuesday at 7 o'clock, the chaplaincy are having an apérol together. So clearly, you sit in front of your computer or your iPhone or your phone, whatever, and you bring your own refreshments. But nonetheless, it is the opportunity that we will have to see the whole face, even if it's only on the screen, and have the opportunity to chat together. I have now discovered how to make the Zoom break up into little rooms, it's called. So basically, when you arrive, I'll then divide us up into groups of about six people so we get to chat, and then I will re-divide us so that you go into other groups of six people, and so that hopefully we'll get to see one another and spend some time together. Other chaplaincies have reported that people enjoy having coffee together. I've always silently thought to myself, well, at St. George's it's more like a glass of wine together, but you know, let's at least try and have some fellowship together. We are also promised the entertainment of watching Peter cook his pancakes, so you never know whether or not you're in the right breakout room and you get to enjoy that scene. Ash Wednesday. Because of the curfew, the Mass at midday on Wednesday will be a sung Eucharist with ashing. Ashing this year is going to be me sprinkling a bit of ash on the top of your head, so it can be like this, in a properly socially distanced COVID-esque way, okay? There will be no smearing of ashes on foreheads and the transmission of potential germs. So, if, of course, work may preclude you attending the Mass, and you might actually fancy something a bit more real than simply watching the Eucharist online. In which case, at 7 o'clock, via Zoom, there will be a short act of penitence, a short penitential rite, sort of start to Ash Wednesday. Okay? It won't take probably more than 20 minutes, that's all. Okay? So there's that opportunity, and clearly if you've want to watch the Eucharist online, that's fine. You don't feel this is not how you start Lent. This is just in order that we feel that COVID is not winning. Okay? Lent. So, during Lent, Mondays, you will receive the email via MailChimp. If you are not receiving an email from St. George's Chaplaincy, that means we don't have your email. If you would like, heaven knows, all sorts of odd people are receiving the email from St. George's, I want to be able to talk to you all directly. So if you would like to receive that email, please email me, chaplain at stgeorgesanglicanchurchparis.org, or email Anne in the office at office at St. George's Paris. Office at St. George's Parish Hall. It's not complicated, is it, really? Office at St. George's Parish Hall. So email them and we'll add you to the thing, and then you'll get all of the information. The Lent book is there. It's going to make for a very good Lent. So on Tuesday at 7 o'clock, there'll be a Lent study group. On Thursday at 7 o'clock, there is a Lent study group. This is not so that you go to the Lent study group on Tuesday and Thursday. That would be beyond keen. Okay? It's just one or other of the evenings, whichever you want. Okay? we have people coming to us from across the globe, so you never know who you will be meeting. On Wednesday at 7 o'clock, there will be Stations of the Cross. Now, this is going to feel very odd, because one of the things about Stations of the Cross is that you pray whilst you're moving, getting away from the very static experience that we have when we come to church. We come, we sit in our place, we stand up, we sit down, but we very rarely move around. Stations is traditionally a moving prayer, like pilgrimage. However, it's COVID, so we can't actually be together. So I thought that if we were to pray and reflect together upon the mysteries of the Via Dolorosa, it's better than nothing. So let's see how it goes. If you'd like to attend at 7 o'clock, and again, the link is all in the email. These links are proving, well, it's me really, because I don't know how to make MailChimp work, but basically you might have to click and paste the links into your browser in order to be able to get to the meeting. If you just click on them, sometimes people have difficulty. I don't know why. Sorry about that. Okay, this Thursday at 8:30, we are reading The Ballad of Reading Gaol. The theology book club will be discussing The Ballad of Reading Gaol. It is very good to see you all here this morning. It is particularly good to see Missy once more. I do want to downplay the transfiguring power of the Eucharist, but if you want a clear and unambiguous example of God's love and transforming grace, all you have to do is offer Missy a belly rub. And the look in her eyes is quite amazing. So it's very nice to see her once more. We stand for our final hymn.
One fold, and the blessing of God Almighty, The Father and the Son and the Holy Spirit be among you and remain with you always.